we are very, very fortunate to have Sri Rajiv ji come around, and he will share his thoughts on the latest topic that he has been working very hard, very passionate, and that's the battle for Sanskrit. More importantly, we have with us a very esteemed citizen of India and a very important person in this battle, Sri N. Gopalaswami, former Chief Election Commissioner of India and the Chancellor of Rashtriya Sanskrit Sansthan Tirupati. He also heads the Kalakshetra here in Chennai. Sri Gopalaswami has been very passionate in making a number of important contributions to the cause of our Sanskrit and our Sanskriti. We also have with us a very eminent scholar, a former principal of Sanskrit College in Malapur here, Sri Krishnamurti Sastrigar. And it's really fortunate that we have an eminent set of people to share their thoughts with us. So request Srimati Lakshmi and Sri Murli to come over here, and request Sri Gopalaswami to take the book out. This is a very different way of doing the book release. This is a very different way of doing the book release. He has to remove the flowers, and from that, within that is the book, and he brings the book out from the tray. That's the way we release the book. It is very different from opening a packet and showing it. Yes.
This is our culture.
Yes. And it's also important to know that Sri Gopalaswami has given the first formal copy to our Sri Krishnamurti Sastrigar. Sri Sampath Iyengar, a very honored, important gentleman, eminent citizen of Chennai, would do the honors of presenting the shawl and a fruit basket to each of the dignitaries on the stage. Thank you, sir. It's for all of us here, Rajiv ji is not an unknown person. Rajiv ji has been on the forefront of bringing out important nuggets of forgotten truths as to how the dynamics of Sanskrit, Sanskriti, and the rest of the world are right now, in what state of affairs they are, and where we are losing out on. So, Rajiv Malhotra ji has been a eminent scholar in his own right. He is a writer, he is a public intellectual, and a person who has been observing keenly the cross-cultural and religious dynamics of our contemporary society, more so in India. Rajiv Malhotra ji will talk on the samanvaya, the harmony between Sanskrit, Sanskriti, and Indian languages. More importantly, bringing out the essence of what he has in his book, The Battle for Sanskrit. Rajiv ji.
Namaskar. I'm going to talk about what the battles are. That's what I'm going to talk about. What are the battles that the book deals with? It's not just Sanskrit as a language, but Sanskriti as a culture, as a civilization. And the overarching battle is to restore the adhikar in the hands of our own people. This adhikar to describe who we are, to study who we are in our own way, to represent ourselves according to our own tradition. This adhikar was taken away during the colonial time. And even after independence, 70 years after independence, this adhikar has not been returned. Many people think that because we have political independence, we also have intellectual independence. We certainly have intellectual freedom legally, and we certainly have free press legally. But the discourse about Indology, Indian civilization, Sanskrit, Sanskriti, is still controlled by mechanisms outside India. And their students and people they have certified who've come back to India and occupied important positions. So the battle is between those who are inside the tradition, like us, all of us, who want to bring this Adhikar back to our control, versus the outsiders who have had this Adhikar, who've taken this Adhikar, and who are in control. So the insiders are not a question of race or ethnicity or geographical location, but anyone who espouses the Vedic Shruti ideas, anyone who practices, who has Shraddha for the tradition, who has sadhana, whose Swadharma is to uphold the tradition, anyone who sees this as his heritage. Those are insiders. And anyone in the world is welcome to accept this. Outsiders are those who reject the insider perspective, who mock at it, make fun of it, denigrate it, say it's irrational, primitive, backward, abusive, oppressive, political, like that. So this battle between insiders and outsiders has been going on, but the insiders are not aware of it. The insiders are not woken up. The insiders are still sleeping or sitting in isolated, very introverted, you know, looking at each other, not able to look out to see who's talking, why are they talking, how to talk back. The insiders are scared. Some insiders have no confidence. They are not competent to read what the outsiders are saying, because the outsiders are writing in very heavy English, which the insiders don't understand. Even the insiders who can understand English properly don't necessarily know all the idiom, all the technical terms being used in Indology, all the references to Western thinkers, Western scholars, Western Siddhant, is confusing the insiders. So the insiders, the traditional scholars of our own civilization, our Sanskriti, are alienated. They are kind of excluded, either by choice or by design. So the battle for Sanskrit is what I'm starting to reverse this trend and bring the Adhikar back. And I call this Swadeshi Indology, which means we have to replace the Videshi Indology with Swadeshi Indology. That's a term. If we can have IT exported from India and become the center, if we can do for pharmaceutical research and export our knowledge, research, if we can do it for auto industry and so many other kind of industries, then why can't we do it for Sanskrit studies and Indology? Why is it that Sanskrit studies and Indology are carried out, the most prestigious centers are in Harvard, Columbia, Chicago, places like Oxford, and so on. And why is it that the most prestigious journals where our scholars have to publish in order to be considered, solid, good scholars, are controlled from the overseas? And why is it that the most important conferences our scholars should go to are overseas? So they're always looking for the mercy of grants and applying to this or that foreign agency to please give me grants so I can go there. We are at the mercy of institutions located elsewhere for our own traditional scholars to certify and to prove their value. This is very sad. This is colonial. Our own Indology is colonized. How can we say we are a superpower and so on when we don't even control our own brand, who we are, our own history, our own discussion of philosophy, itihas, somebody else doing it and teaching us. So we used to be the producers of knowledge in places like Nalanda. And we used to teach the world. Now it has switched. The guru has become the consumer. We have become the consumer of knowledge. Others are producing and teaching us. This is very strange. So our young, bright people are taken overseas. They go and do this PhD. They come back and they get a professorship in Sanskrit or Indology or Indian history or social sciences or something like that. They come back and then they propagate the Western knowledge which they have learnt. And they're always in touch with their headquarters somewhere in the West. I'm not against the West. West is a wonderful civilization. They have made many, many contributions and they have done a lot of good work. I am for Western ideals, free market, R&D, technology, science. I am all for that. But when it comes to Indology, I think Indology, the center of the world of Indology, ought to belong here. And although I'm from the North, and I spend a lot of my time in Delhi, four times a year I come to India, I always make a tour of the South in every trip. So, and I come four times. But my original place is, until I was 20, I lived in Delhi. And then for 45 years, I've lived in the US. So although my collections have mainly been with Delhi, I concluded that this renaissance, this revival of Sanskrit and Sanskriti cannot be done in Delhi. Delhi is too political and too difficult because the moment you start talking like this, there is a lot of hostility. Now, of course, ultimately we have to win Delhi, ultimately. But I think that a base to start taking back Sanskriti has to be in the South, where more talent is available, traditional scholars are available. I have given some talks in Bangalore, and I found that the Karnataka Sanskrit University are very, very excited. They would like to help me. They would like to appoint some Sanskrit scholars and help me give traditional responses. Yesterday morning at the Sanskrit University here in Chennai, again, the people there were very happy. They announced very publicly that my job should be to define the problems, to define the questions, the purva paksha of the prominent Western Indologists, and their job is to supply the uttara paksha. So we can be in partnership. We can be in partnership, and I'm hoping that as a result of these talks during this trip, we can create some kind of a team of traditional scholars in the South and maybe also from other places, but maybe mainly controlled, or the base can be somewhere here. And that's my first goal in this battle, is to create a what I call home team of traditional intellectuals, and then I can coach them on what the Western Indology is saying, and their job is to give responses. So we can be a team. I want to apply the tradition of purva paksha, of studying others, and I can help them, guide them as to where the material is, give them the bibliography, the annotated bibliography, the reading list, guide them on how to read it, and let them read it for themselves and come up with answers. That is their job. The second part of this is so the first home team is A, let's call it A, that's the traditional scholars. Then there is another B team, which is intellectuals who are westernized, but who are on our wavelength. These are people in media, these are various scholars, these are public intellectuals, writers, thinkers, people like that. So yesterday morning was Sanskrit University. That's where I hope to bring people into my A team, traditional scholars. And yesterday afternoon was IIT Madras, which would be a good fertile ground to find people on the B team, because they're not necessarily traditional Sanskrit scholars. They are very passionate about our heritage. They are anglicized, westernized, English speaking, articulate. And we need those people. We need those people because that's how much of our society has become and is becoming more and more rapidly. So we need a multi-prong attack. Then I think there is a need for a Team C. Team C are people who are very active in social media. They're not intellectuals and scholars either traditional Sanskrit, nor are they writers in English, but they can be very effective in spreading the knowledge, spreading the message, in publicizing, in public relations, publicity, using social media. And the reason they are especially important is that the traditional media blocks us out. Traditional media don't talk about our view unless it is to criticize. So we don't exist normally. This view does not exist unless it's time to attack it. Then suddenly it becomes very prominent. And the only antidote we have to that so far is our followers on social media do a very good job of responding. So that is my third team. So the three teams are, I need the serious traditional scholars who can dig up all kind of good responses to what the Indology people are writing. Second is the westernized intellectuals who can write these ideas in English and spread it to policymakers, IAS, IFS people, NCRT people, HRD people, media people, and so on. Okay. And the C team, third one, is those who can take it to, who are not producers in Sanskrit or in any language, in English or anything, but who can take the message in very simple blogs and social media and Twitter and Facebook and all that stuff. That is very important. The three-pronged attack, three levels, are all very necessary. Now, what I want to achieve is have many, many readers. I want thousands of readers who read the book and who are quoting from the book, because that is how we fight the battle. We don't fight the battle being emotional. We don't fight the battle hitting below the belt and personal insults and abuses. So I don't want it to turn into that. I want to keep the dignity of the discussion. I want to have respect for my opponents. I have nothing personal against my opponents. They're bright scholars. I call them the Charvakas of the 21st century. They are the 21st century Charvakas. I have a section in this book called Return of the Charvakas. So I call them Charvakas 2.0, because the original Charvakas were also very bright in Sanskrit. These people also know a lot of, they are very intellectual, they're very hardworking when they come here. They're not lazy people, they run around. They're hardworking people and they deserve merit for that. Like the original Charvakas, the new ones are also against the Vedas. They don't accept Shruti, Praman. They are against anything to do with sacredness. They are materialists, they're atheists. So they resemble the old Charvakas. But the new Charvakas are more powerful. They are connected with world power centers, lot of funding, lot of political institutional power, clout. They're connected with media on their side. That is the way I characterize the Indian left. They're Marxists, atheists, they are anti-Vedic, anti-Hindu, and they are a part of a global nexus against our civilization. And unlike the original Charvaks, they carry a lot of clout. They are articulate, very hard-working people, lot of money coming their way. So the new Charvaks are more dangerous than the old Charvaks. The new Charvaks are a combination of Westerners and their Indian students, Indian chelas, Indian followers. The Westerner guru, Charvak, and the Indian student Charvak are a team. And we have not even studied this. We have not even understood this is what's going on. So my main contribution is to give you the map of the Kurukshetra, to tell you who's who, what is going on. Please wake up. Please do something. That is my job, to motivate our traditional people who know a lot more than I do to get up and do something. And until now, we are giving all these Padam Shri, Padam Bhushan awards to these Charvaks. We've been giving. And we've been, Murthy has given them millions of dollars to take control over the future presentation of our heritage using the translation standards that these Charvaks are defining. They are defining how to translate a certain word. They are imposing their ideology of Aryan theory and this and that and Dalit, the whole this divisiveness using caste and whatnot. So they are bringing this human rights agenda. They are bringing these social sciences from the West. In other words, their Siddhanta, their Niti, they are bringing their kind of ideas in order to study Sanskrit. And they are saying they want to champion and revive the study of Sanskrit, but it should be done in this new way, not the traditional way. So they are championing Sanskrit, no doubt. But our people are foolish, applauding them, thinking, wow, this guy is very great. He talks, he's championing. What our people are not doing is to read beneath the surface and figure out what exactly is their purpose and what exactly is their strategy for championing the Sanskrit. They're championing Sanskrit as something that should be devoid and deleted of the paramarthika dimension, only vyavarika. That's a very typical materialist, leftist view that what matters in studying a culture is the daily life, social life, and so on. And the spiritual life is all hocus pocus according to them. It is full of oppression and it's very primitive and backward and exploitation and whatnot. So that paramarthika dimension of the Vedic should be sidelined. This is what they're saying. The oral tradition also should be sidelined because it is part of old Brahmin, you know, just keeping it secret but not writing it down. And oral cannot allow progress to happen. As long as it's oral, then nothing new will come. So history, according to them, starts when writing comes. And therefore, they can dismiss a large part of our history. They can dismiss it by saying we don't have records, or because oral, nobody can prove what was done. Written only we can prove because there's evidence. So the oral is sort of useless as far as history is concerned. It's very convenient for them to do these things. And we have to point it out. We have to give them, with respect, their right of speech and intellectual discourse. They have a right to do what they're doing. But we have a right to respond. We are not stopping them. We are just waking up our people to respond. That's all. So we can have good, honest, you know, vibrant debates. That's what we want. So besides removing the sacred, they are also introducing the exploitation as the purpose and motive of a lot of the texts and political hegemony, political domination. They remove one thing, which is sacred, and in its place, they add two things, social oppression and political dominance. So the lens, the context, because every interpretation requires context. The context of the original tradition is removed, which is sacredness, and the context of the new Charvaka is introduced, which is, you know, social oppression as the context through which it should be, this tradition should be studied, and political domination. So sacredness is removed, and politics and social sciences oppressive study of oppression and human rights is introduced. This comprises, according to me, a big compromise. Such people should not be given the representation of Shingeri Mutt, which is what Shingeri almost did, and I hope we can win the battle. We still don't know. Such groups should not be handed millions of dollars to translate 500 volumes of our tradition into English and spread it in inexpensive, you know, just blast the whole market with inexpensive editions, which is what Murthy wants to do with these people. So I have no right to, no adhikar to stop other people from spending their money. I have no right, they have every adhikar, all these parties I'm naming have every right to do what they're doing, but my right is also to speak and express my opinion. And this is a marketplace of ideas. And if I can convince enough people, and hopefully they'll be open-minded, rather than getting angry at me, I'm just making a contribution in my own humble way by giving my analysis based on what I have found. And they can, after I've done all this, they can dismiss it and continue doing what they are doing, or they can compromise, or they can reject what they were previously thinking of doing. They could say, let's rethink what we are doing, and so on. So I'm here. These are the battles that I am here to initiate through this book. A final point I want to make is the government of India needs to be better informed, because the government of India, very busy in its agendas and its priorities, which are very commendable, those are very remarkable things, has unfortunately been infiltrated. Some of the centers of Indology have gotten Indians, Hindus related to the government involved in representing their case in Delhi. So these guys are coming around talking because they have friends, they have access, they're coming and talking. There is a discussion of a $50 million Government of India budget to help Western Indology. please note this. This is not official, but people who are proudly lobbying are bragging that they'll get that. Yeah. Whether they get that remains to be seen. But a lot of these things are done quietly until it's too late. Somehow, suddenly something gets announced. And then people sort of argue and fight and say, why wasn't there public discussion? And then it starts creating a sort of strange negative atmosphere. So I would like, if people have connections, if people know somebody, to at least sound the alarm, that put the brakes on it. Like I was able to do with Shingeri. I went to the Shankaracharya. I was able to say, please, ultimately, I respect you so much that whatever you do, we will, is fine. But please give me a chance to finish my book or finish my report. Look at it, and then you can decide. At least have the other side of the story. This book is now out, and you should have important people in the government read it. And call me, call other side, the other side, and let's have a debate. Let's argue the pros and cons. My case is very simple. The argument being made by the other side is that India cannot do its own R&D in Sanskrit because they don't have good people. The best people are Westerners. And I'm saying that's unacceptable. Firstly, I don't believe that's true. I think that the use of English language has kind of handicapped our people. And secondly, they have not funded properly. They're not able to create good careers for bright people. If these problems were resolved, and if we upgraded the training of our people on international discourse and so on, debates and so on, you know, there is no reason our very, very bright Sanskrit people would not be upgraded to match and exceed other people's capabilities. If we can be so good in other fields, why can't we be the best in the world in Indology, in Sanskrit studies? Of course we should be. The best journals in Mandarin studies and China studies are in China, not in the United States. And they are controlled by Chinese editorial people. The best journals in the world on Japan studies are in Japan. French studies are written in French, not English. Arabic studies are in Arabic. Persian studies are controlled in Iran. Russian studies are in Russia. We are the only major civilization whose study is controlled elsewhere on the terms of other people. They have the adhikar to certify who's good and who's not good. And we are so obliged and happy and thankful to them for studying us. It's like, gee, thank you so much for considering me so important and worth your while. It's like when somebody asked King George V, I believe, why you taken the Kohinoor? According to one report, he said, the people of the empire should be very proud that I've chosen their diamond to wear on my head. That sort of thing. Like, I'm a thief, I come to your house, steal all your art and your jewelry, and you should be very proud that this very important guy is now wearing your jewelry. It shows a sign of your good taste, and I'm honoring your jewelry. I'm praising it. This is the kind of inferiority complex our people have. And so the battle is a very multi-pronged, multifaceted battle. It's a very risky battle for me. I stick my neck out and I get hit every morning, you don't know. The first thing I've stopped looking at email in the morning because I get 100 threats and whatnot, you're doing this and that, all kind of stuff coming to me. And I'm alone. I have to figure out what to do. But more and more young people are also helping me deal with this kind of a thing. So it's a kind of a thankless job. It's a job that can completely deplete your pran. It has to be done. Somebody has to do it. If a person has career ambitions in some institutions, he may not want to do it because it's too controversial. I have no career ambitions. I'm doing this for the last 25 years full time. I don't want anything out of it. So nobody can fire me and nobody can hire me. I'm not for sale. So that being the case, I can take this risk, and that's what I'm trying to do. And so I want to conclude by saying that instead of the government giving money to Indology, the government, I would like to appoint a commission for studying and monitoring the state of Indology in the world. China has a commission that every year produces a report on how China studies is taking place in different countries. They have 100 plus Confucian institutes that study, that are named after Confucius. But these are institutes that are set up all over the world, and academics and various places, to promote Chinese idea of history, philosophy, ideology, language, all of that. So like Alliance Francaise does for French, and then there's people doing it for Russian and whatnot. And Saudis invest a lot in doing this for Arabic and so on. So China has these Confucian institutes spreading their grand narrative, their civilizational ethos, their idea of Sanskriti, very successfully. And one of the projects of these institutes is to produce an annual report that goes to the Chinese government and industry and so on who is doing what on China studies in the world, what are they doing, who's funding them, who are the good guys, who are the bad guys. They keep track. This is their monitoring. They're monitoring the state of China studies in the world. So at the very least, the Indian government should appoint a commission for the monitoring and evaluation of Indology in the world. This is what I would like to see happen. And rather than spending $50 million to give to those guys, we should just spend $1 million and study that first. I mean, no industrialist enters an industry without first getting a report. You don't just go enter an airline or start a hotel business or start some business in pharmaceuticals if it is something new that you don't understand. You first hire a McKinsey or somebody like that to do an industry report. So instead of going and just dumping some money, $50 million, and actually feeding the other side, we have to put a tiny amount of that money for the first few years and understand the state of the art. And then we can negotiate with confidence, with knowledge. Even if you want to give money, you give it later on, after you have acquired a lot of knowledge on what is going on, so you can sit down as an equal with a lot of knowledge and talk to them as an equal and not have to be begging. The answer I get often is that if we give them enough money, we'll win them over. I call that feeding the crocodile. You feed the crocodile thinking he'll become like a nice dog, polite dog. Yeah, a lot of our people, I tell them, you're confusing. When the crocodile is showing his teeth, you think he wants to smile for a selfie with you. Yeah, I mean, the crocodile's DNA is not going to change just because you keep feeding him. So the DNA of the Western Indology is not because they're bad people, please. They are rooted in a certain civilizational assumption, a certain civilizational history, a grand narrative that they are taught from childhood. This is their DNA. This is how they are. Like we have a certain Sanskriti, sanskars we have. Chinese have their sanskars and their ideas. Arabs have theirs. Persians have theirs. Like that. So the Westerners have a certain Western sanskar, a certain Western ethos, values. And it is very natural when they come and study Indology, they project those ideas to us. They may be very polite and diplomatic. Some of them are very, very decent people. They are very generous people. All of them are not, the kind that I'm worried about. Some of them are very nice also. But some of them are double, They play both roles. They'll be very, very nice. They'll come in a dhoti with a tilak and they'll do all these kind of things. But some of them will come as students at the feet of our gurus and teachers. But the teacher is not sophisticated enough to track what did he write when he went back. When he went back and he had to write, did he even acknowledge the teacher properly? Did he distort? And yesterday, the traditional Sanskrit scholars, after they heard me, some of them said things like, what we write in one or two sentences, they often take 3-4 pages to explain, and they go on repeating the same thing and often get it wrong also. Yeah. Now, the correct protocol would be when a Westerner comes here and he picks the brain of a traditional pandit, a traditional scholar, often for days, weeks, months. Correct protocol should be that as a courtesy, when he goes back and writes, before publishing the draft, he should send the draft back and say, is it correct? And give this person the right to put a rebuttal as at the end of his draft. So if he's written a 30-page paper, he should go back to the traditionalist and say, would you like to write 5-6-page response, rebuttal, your Uttar Paksh, your Purva Paksh and Uttar Paksh, what I've written. And that whole thing should be published. That is never done. So our traditional people are too naive to even bother. They are too afraid to pursue this matter and demand. So in a sense, they're being treated like native informants. Native informant is a very derogatory term. The anthropologists come to some poor villager to learn about that village so they can write about it. So they go to some village, talk to some poor women, and that's anthropology. The native informants, they're called, have no right to talk back, no mechanism to talk back, no understanding that they should talk back. Not given the decency and dignity of who they are, a kind of a Western stereotyping of who they are to fit the human rights machinery, the human rights international campaign against our civilization, is being fed with all this stuff. So the pundits and the scholars who are so knowledgeable, and the Westerners should be sitting at their feet. This is the other way around. This scholar thinks he's obliged to that young fellow who's got a lot of money. If that guy gives him a ticket to go overseas, he thinks his life is made. So the economic asymmetry has been turned into an asymmetry of adhikar. We now have the money. Why are we dependent? I mean, this is very strange. We should be funding our people rather than funding foreign people. That's my battle for Sanskrit. Thank you very much.
Malhotra and friends. I would not go over some of the ground which is already very well brought out before you. But I thought I'll just read something which, you know, it came extreme tremendous surprise to me, which I'm sure when you go through that book you will also note. But I thought I'll just read that few sentences. Mr. Malhotra writes in his book at page 4, and all of you are aware of the millions of Jews were killed in Germany by the Nazis. Very interestingly now, the Western, so-called Western intelligentsia on their deduction, they have come to the conclusion that they did it because of Sanskrit and our Sanskriti. That is, England did its atrocities during colonial rule. Nazis were killed in Germany thanks to you and me or our tradition. How absurd can you get? But this is what they write. I described how he placed, is about one of the important persons. I mean, our Krishnamurti Sasikal mentioned that that name has been taken quite a few times in this book. I am referring to that person. Blame for European racism, Nazism is being placed at the door of Sanskrit. More especially, he has written extensively claiming Brahmin elitism was a factor in shaping ideologies of British colonialism and German Nazism, and that social oppressiveness built into Sanskrit has contributed to the legitimation of genocide. So you borrow Sanskrit from me, you misinterpret it, and then you find an excuse for killing some people there and put it at my door. Such things should open our eyes. I must tell you that, you know, colonialism was there, is there, will be there. It's not dead. Only thing is, it has changed its colors. The leopard is a leopard, but it is slightly changing its colors. That's about all. Earlier, it was actually capturing your land, physically holding your land, taking your wealth. Today, it is on a different footing altogether. It's intellectually trying to dominate you. That is, and you know, in that they employ all kinds of tools. Money is, of course, one of them. You learn from me, and then you write something totally different without even, as Rajivji pointed out, without even showing to me what you have written. I remember I was in the National Human Rights Commission. Sometimes I used to think that the entire human rights discourse was again something which they used to oppress other countries. And don't mistake me that I'm not saying anything against human rights activism, in the sense if there are exploitation, if there are mistakes which or is there violence by one human being against another in this country, all of us are responsible for it and we must take due action to ensure that such violation doesn't take place. But the interesting part of it was that somebody sitting in Geneva, somebody sitting in New York is always finger pointing, saying that you are a violator of human rights. And what does he do? He goes and bombs Iraq. He creates mayhem in the Middle East. And I'm quite sure another 50 years later, these fellows will write saying that we bombed Iraq because of Sanskrit. So what is that? Bombing Iraq? It's not human rights violation? It is. But who will ask them? Because they're all already pointing fingers at you. And somebody said famously that when you are pointing an accusing finger on somebody, three fingers are pointing out to yourself. But that doesn't bother them, because we don't have the power, we don't have the clout to ask back, saying that what you're doing, what you did in Kuwait, what you did in Iraq, what you're doing elsewhere in Syria is something which is equally reprehensible. No way. I mean, none of us are asking the question. So it emboldens them. That's something which is happening here in this field also. So if I say that maybe this is all part of in place of economic dominance, this is the intellectual dominance, again to the same goal of economic dominance. I don't think I'm too wrong. However, maybe some people would like to think that is a debatable issue. Let it be. So the thing which we need to understand is that colonialism still thrives, and that we are still a target of it, and how we should try and save, as Mr. Rajiv Malhotra says, get back that adhikar for interpreting our text, for interpreting correctly. And I must appreciate what Mr. Malhotra is saying, in the sense, he doesn't say that reject whatever they say. Treat it as their stand, refute it, and point out how it is wrong. That's the best way of debate and discussion which this country, in this land, which has followed. Every little way, there is a Purva Paksha, there is a Uttara Paksha, you understand his points and refute it. So that is how he is wanting. I mean, so one need not become emotional or up to any physical violence. But that doesn't mean that we should accept the demonization which is being done, the finger pointing which is being done repeatedly in very many subtle ways. And he is not wrong in saying that many of us fall prey to this, sometimes unwittingly, sometimes very much knowing what is happening. If you are given a scholarship, if you are given some facility, you jump at it and go. You think that a great favor has been done to you. But that intellectual, your intellectual brainwashing which takes place is something which maybe you do not realize. Maybe you realize, but your materialistic outlook makes you think that, yes, it is worthwhile because I get my pockets full of money. But there is definite danger which we must be aware of. And this efforts go a very long way. These efforts go a very long way. We need to look at every of these issues with a very clear thought and understanding the background behind it. The discourse which is started in order to make one community against the other. Long back, it was the Aryan invasion theory. And after that, it is Aryan migration theory. They are still finding out where that Aryan fellow, alien fellow or Aryan fellow, where they have not still located him. But they are very happy with the theory that Aryan invasion theory. And when it is proved, disproved, then they said, okay, it's all right. I mean, he didn't invade, yes, but he did migrate. Okay. So now you have another step to cross. When you prove it is not migration because the DNA shows that all of us are the same, then they will say, acha, this is, you know, some other theory will come up saying that still that Aryan word has to be used. They made that point to divide this country into Aryan Dravidian, and the effects of it are to be seen for a long time. But one must understand that. One must understand that this is something which is intellectual domination through some of these very, very, very subtle methods. And if we don't realize that, and if we don't try and act against it, if we don't try to get together and see that it is properly refuted, a time will come when our Sanskriti and Sanskriti also will go down. So that is something which Mr. Malhotra has very rightly pointed out. It's a tremendously interesting book. Facts gathered very painstakingly, and at every point he has been very fair, saying that this is their standpoint, and this is my standpoint. Where it's not a book which simply says that in abusive language or in a language of I know everything, and I don't have to care to what you say. He points out what their arguments are, and he points out how they are wrong. And that is where we need to help him. We need to help ourselves. It's not helping one Mr. Rajiv Malhotra. It's actually this civilization, if it's got to survive, it has got to help itself. And nobody else can do that for you. In fact, in a meeting of the vice chancellors of Sanskrit universities on the 20th, I had an occasion to read a few portions of this book, and some of them was totally scandalized, especially when I mentioned saying that you people are responsible. All these people, 16 Sanskrit University vice chancellors sitting there, Sanskrit, you are responsible that all the Jews were killed. So I think they got a shock of their life. And that is what is being written. We are not aware of it. We are not aware of it, and we are not. Some are aware of it, but don't care for it. And there was one person at least who was very vehemently arguing later on with me, saying about the money which came from there. They're not bad people and all that. And then I had to sit down and talk to him, saying that after I read this to you, you still think that they're not bad people? And just because they are funding you? In fact, I told him right there when he said some money is coming, I mean, we are collaborating so and so and getting money and all that stuff. I said, look at the color of that money, what color it is. Please be aware of it. So without much ado, I would like to say that a very well written book, but it should not remain as a book. Actually, it should be the starting point for an action. And I'm quite sure that some of us sitting at the places where we are in a position to contribute something to it. And I'm quite sure this will be done. And he's already pointed out what things are being done at the government, and what needs to be at least ensured that it doesn't happen. So I think those of us who can help those issues will certainly take note of it and try and do our best to ensure that it doesn't go the wrong way. Thank you very much, and it is a wonderful book. I commend this to you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you for reading it. I mean, this is what I like, is serious intellectuals on our side taking the time, reading the whole thing. He's read it and pointed out many things to me, which I'm very happy. So the point about this claim that he mentioned by the Western Indologists, that Sanskrit holds a deep structures of oppression, which the Europeans discovered. And they said, we can use it. And they started becoming oppressive. Now, There's a paper called Deep Orientalism. If you search, read that paper, written some 20 years ago or whatever. Now, my view is, they have a right to theorize, but it would have been an honest thing for somebody writing that to come to the Sanskrit University here, to come to the vice chancellors, and on their face present it and say, this is my thesis, please give me a response. Correct? Not to quietly just publish it all over the world and teach people in Columbia and Chicago about these ideas, and then these ideas keep spreading. And it takes 20 years and a man like me to bring it to the attention of the traditionalists. So traditionalists should not be in the dark. Now, when I've mentioned this to Sheldon Pollock, who's the guy who wrote this, he made a good argument. He said, I asked him, I said, why is it that I'm the first person who's done a very thorough analysis and written about your work? Important scholar should be critiqued. It's a tradition. And how come nobody has done it? He gave a very correct answer. He said, I've never stopped them. They're welcome to. Why didn't they do it? I don't know. Why didn't they do it? He's correct. I said that your students are writing hagiographies, praising you, prashastis and all that. And all Indian, all kind of authorities giving you awards. Nobody written a critique to kind of balance out the discussion. And he made an absolutely correct statement that he's never stopped anybody. People should do it. They're welcome to doing it. If they do it in a good, friendly tone and respect and all that, there's no problem. So the blame also goes to us in the sense that why is it that 20 years have gone by with this article, and many other articles have written, another one on the death of Sanskrit, a very classical article, why it has been dead for 1,000 years, Hindu kings were responsible for killing it, no responsibility to Mughals and Islamic invasion, very clear. Now why is it that for so long, nobody from our side even bothered to take note of it and write a rebuttal? That's it, that's our problem. Are we scared? Are we not able to read English? Whatever the issue is, we ought to be honest and address it. We ought to unblock the intellectual capacity of our people, which is very large. We have to unblock that, polish it up, clean up whatever the problems are, and turn them loose as a very serious intellectual force, not emotional. There is a whole thesis they have that Ramayana was not popular in the public. It was a very sort of small scale tradition until the Turks invaded 1,000 years ago. And then Hindu kings suddenly wanted to popularize Ramayana as rabble rousing against the Muslims. And the way to rabble rouse against the Muslims was a narrative in which the Hindu king was divine, like Ram, and the foreign invader was Ravana, the Rakshas. So the demonic other and the divine self of king was the way the Ramayana was developed for this particular anti-Muslim use. Now this is so clearly written. It's written on the occasion of this Babri Masjid Ayodhya thing, again, by the same authors, refreshing their readers' memory that, look, I told you so, and this is why they're doing it. Now, okay, everyone's entitled to their view. I do not want to stop this or have burned books. You know, I do not want that. Please, don't. They have a right. But we should have responded at intellectual conferences. We should have written papers, rebuttaling, very strong rebuttals. We should have done that. So that is all I'm trying to do. I'm trying to level the playing field of intellectual discourse by asking our people to respond in a very dignified, intellectual, academic style with facts. I mean, you can give facts. I have given an appendix showing that long before the Turkish invasion, there were Ram temples, archaeological sites, you can see. There's evidence there's a Ram Leela. Ramayana and its story had been exported to Thailand and Cambodia, Angkor Wat, all these kind of things. So to say that it became popular as a reaction to for rabble rousing when the Turks came is factually wrong. I mean, there's nothing emotional about it. No insult being given. Just saying that this is wrong scholarship. This scholarship has enough doubts. Even if you don't want to call it wrong, there is counter evidence also. The evidence is not all one-sided. That's the kind of style I'm using. So I thank you and I thank you, sir, for your wonderful remarks. And maybe we can take questions.
Yeah.
Just one intervention, because he did mention about Ramayana, and of course in his book he has written extensively the evidence which is against the theory of Ramayana coming into coming into prominence after the Turkish invasion. I don't know how many of you had noted a news item which came in the last 3-4 days. An archaeologist who was with Archaeological Survey of India for many years, he has given a statement saying that when he did the work at the field excavation, he found enough evidence, pillars, for a temple there in Ayodhya. How many newspapers have carried it? Very few. But the refutal immediately was carried. So somebody immediately said that he's talking nonsense, there was no such thing at all. The man was at the site and he has no compulsion to say something false. Incidentally, he happens to be a Muslim. He's an archaeologist to start with. Incidentally, he's a Muslim, and he says he found during the excavation there were pillars indicating that there was a temple. None of us, I mean, we need to read that. We need to look at. So two things were said immediately. One, he doesn't know what he's talking about. Two, he is saying this because the Kerala elections are round the corner. It doesn't appeal to me at all. In the sense, what has Kerala election to do with Ram Temple and indicated, I mean, the information given by an archaeologist, person who actually did the excavation, and incidentally also happens to be a Muslim. But this is the lie part of it that will get carried on, that what he is saying is not true, there was no such thing. So immediately that school has started, you know, if you see the thing, that school has started saying that all that he says is wrong. I mean, so now I don't know what proof one can give beyond your two eyes. If you say that I have worked there and I have seen this, unfortunately, that report is not out. He has spoken, the person who worked. But the report prepared by them is not out, thanks to all our courts, who think that the best way to, allow lies to be spread is to suppress the truth, which is, of course, the ordinary, the normal way. Thank you.
This is a very short intervention. The fact that the temple existed at that site has been accepted by the Allahabad High Court explicitly and unambiguously. So there's no doubt about it anywhere.
Your name?
My name is Nagarajan. I work with the Temple Worshipper Society.
Very good. Thank you so much. Thank you. So we'll take questions,
yes,
for which you should please arrange a mic.
Yeah.
Recently, I met a gentleman in the music season in Chennai. He's from Eastern Europe. And when he went back, he admired everything about India. But when he went back, when I looked at his Facebook, I saw absolute poverty-stricken photographs. He probably published about 30 of them. And he came to my house, he had lunch, he had dinner, he had discussions, and praised India. But when you go to the West, as you know, they still bring out the bad side, the evil side of India. That's one thing I have noticed, because there are mansions and mansions here, rich people are here. Not that I'm saying there is no poverty. There's poverty in Washington, D.C. also, because part of my time is spent in Washington, D.C. So what you have said, when they go back, the way that they promote things, in this particular case, photographs, in what you mentioned, is about Sanskriti and our Sanskrit, our language and all that. And one more thing I have noticed, the Christianity is slowly spreading in such a subtle way. If you want to be a Christian, sure, that's okay, but don't trick the people. Now they are constructing dvajastambhas, just like we have Hindu temples. So when you are converting, when you are converting somebody, you don't want to drastically say, become a Christian, otherwise you will go to hell. They are not doing that anymore. They're slowly, gently trying to make a Hindu who is obviously not established in his own samskriti or her own samskriti. If they were, they would not do that. But unfortunately, as he said, if we understand our samskriti and if we get established in our samskriti, I am sure nobody can invade us, nobody can interrupt us, nobody can interpret us in a wrong way. I just wanted to share the thought. From now on, maybe the questions are the ones that you would want. Sure. Thank you so much.
Sure. Those are very good points. The sad thing is, and I've studied this whole phenomenon of Christians wanting to make everything same, to create a bridge, making it easy for Hindus to go over to Christianity by putting Jesus as a lotus position, he's a yogi, and Mary is in a sari, and she's wearing bindi, and you do arti to Mary, and all the familiarities, so you don't make it unfamiliar to convert, you make it easy to convert. This is called enculturation, and this strategy was started in Latin America by the church, because they found that some people could be converted direct, abrupt, quick, and some they required to gently move over. It was a two-generation process. Generation one, they would tell them that your deity, your village deity, your ancestral deity is fine, we're not bothering. We also put Jesus and Mary along with your room, where your temple is. And so it is all harmony, we are all one and all that. And so they would bring Jesus and Mary, you know, icons into the traditional temple. And then they would start a Christian convent school where they would say, well, I will teach our children. So they teach the children. They teach the children that those are deities are actually false gods, but we should not disrespect our parents. So at home, you please respect them. But we are telling you who the truth is, what the truth is. Now when, so there's harmony in the family. The children kind of obey the family rituals also. But they're being indoctrinated that that is all actually false. We're just doing it out of decency. Yeah. And then when these children grow up, become important in their own independent, then they are told that, you know, that thing about your parents and all that was dies with the parents only. It is all old stuff. It is all bogus. It is all bad, evil. And it's time to remove all those old idols. So now the Christianity becomes blatant. So it's this is called enculturation. It says, enter friendly, in a friendly way. Saam and Daan, don't do bhed and dand until later. First, enter the home, become a good guest. Praise. Yeah. This is a strategy. This is taught. There is so much. If you look at Christian's doctrine on inculturation, if you look that up, you'll find hundreds of papers, thousands of papers. They're discussed in seminaries. It's taught. In Islam, this is called al-taqiyah. Al-taqiyah means where you are not in power, then you should be very diplomatic. You should respect everything and keep quiet, low profile. Like that. So these strategies come to traditions that have a export expansion history and experience. When you are a marketing company, your sales force develop a lot of good strategies because you know what works, what doesn't work. You keep improving. Yeah. If you are a company that doesn't market, you just wait for somebody to come and he has to come to you. You don't ever go out and expand, market. Then you do not even know these strategies. So we have, since we are not an expansionist civilization, we don't even know what the strategies are being used on us because we never use them on others. But when you talk to a Muslim about this Christian strategy, it doesn't take him more than 2 seconds to figure out exactly what they're doing because he knows it. Similarly, when you talk to a Christian, that this is what they will immediately tell you because the Abrahamic religions have done this to each other. And so they understand. We are only at the receiving side. Now, the sad thing is you expect our gurus, acharyas, our swamis to be like this, to understand it. I won't name, but we were together, Mohanji and I, at one of the prominent mathas yesterday, day before. Yes. And the head Swami of this temple is very impressed. He's want picture with me and this and that, put on Facebook. He's my friend, he knows me, my works, he introduces me to his son. He's very supportive of me, he's very happy I've written these books, full of praise, taking us around everywhere. He's the head temple priest. And at the end, he says, we are so great because we have no problem, we can bring Jesus inside here, temple. We have no problem, sir. We can bring Mary, we can bring anything if you want, it doesn't affect us. I had no time to give him a lecture on how that enculturation is a foolish idea. You must have a very clear identity. Similarly, in Bangalore, we were with this, probably one of the most famous Hindu organizations of good lineage. And we were with a Swami who's in their national board of governors. And he's giving a very passionate, how we're losing Hinduism. How you go, wherever you go, these guys are gone. Our people don't know anything. They're ignorant. Nobody is teaching them Hinduism. And all of them are being taken over. And the spread of these other religions is so rapid. He's fiery. He's very fiery. And yet, and then I point out to him, I didn't tell him your organization. I just said, don't you think there's a responsibility in all this of those Hindu organizations that teach sameness of all religions? He was very quiet because his own organization teaches that. So we are mixed up. Our leaders are mixed up. Our leaders are very mixed up in the name of political correctness, a kind of a distorted idea of Vedanta. In the Paramarthika realm, everything being one doesn't mean that in the Vivarika realm, you can't differentiate between Dharma and Adharma. You see, in the Vivarika realm, in the Laukika realm, there is Dharma, there is Adharma. There is truth, there is false. There is avidya. There are different type of gunas. There is difference. If there were no difference, why would Krishna waste his time telling you about those guys that you have to fight? How? Our people are very good at citing the oneness of the Paramarthika and foolishly applying it as if it applies here. So this is such common sense that our people don't have. So I think we have problems. And we have to solve our problems in order to resist the external threats. Thank you.
Yeah. Come forward. Yeah.
A lot of intellectuals, and many of them Indian, you know, they assert that India never existed before 1947. This actually raises a question on our own Sanskriti also. You know, they also attribute a lot of the progress that we made and us even existing as a country to the British. So how do you respond
okay.
to that?
So in this book, I raise that issue. I raise that issue which says there is no such thing as Indian civilization and there has never been a nation until recent times. And I use the category Sanskriti and say, look at its what the texts say about Sanskriti. The idea of Rashtra. See, we have to use our categories to defend. Not, you can't do a search on nation and you won't find it. Obviously, you'll find it only in British times. So what has been written about the idea of Sanskriti in our texts? What is the, how come Adi Shankara decided to walk this land? If this land, he didn't have a sense of unity of this particular land, why would he go to all these corners? Obviously, he had a sense of unity. Why? How come the Kumbh Mela has been, there is record of 8 to 10,000 years of Kumbh Mela, of people coming from every corner of this land. So there's a sense of unity of purpose, unity of yajna, a cosmic unity. How come we have these Shaktipitams from Pakistan also? Pakistan, all over South Asia, we have these Shaktipitams. So whether you are in the Shakti tradition, whether you are in the Akharas, The Kumbh Mela is run by 13 Akhadas, as you know, sadhus. They're from all over India. Whether you're from the Vedanta tradition, whatever tradition you are in, the point is you'll see the practice, the symbols, the lineage presence all over. And this is way before colonialism. It's our people who don't know these things. And we need to stand up and talk about it. In this book, I'm giving that response to this very issue.
Next question.
Good morning, sir. My name is Vijay Arun. I just wanted to ask a question regarding funding, basically, for Sanskrit studies. If you notice, most of the Sanskrit universities, one of the common themes which I'm seeing is everybody is looking for funding. And that's the case with the Madras Sanskrit College as well. If you go to their website, they say that we are only partly funded, but we still need about 42 lakhs to run our operations. So this is probably the case for many Sanskrit universities which are there. Is this a reason why our scholars are not able to respond with a lot of confidence? They are more worried about survival rather than actually responding to the Western Indologists. That's one of my questions.
I'll partly answer that, and then of course leave it to Mr. Rajiv Malhotra to answer the rest of the... As far as the funding is concerned, I think no university will now come forward and say that we have all the funds. None of them, whether it is the state or the center, no university gets the kind of funds which asked for. So that is not the issue at all. As far as Sanskrit Madras Sanskrit College is concerned, it's a separate issue. It's actually a privately funded institution. It used to get some funds from the government of India. Then they chose to opt out of a particular scheme because they found that some of the conditions of the scheme were not conducive to their working. Therefore, they decided to opt out. Now, you know, we are trying to see whether some of these institutions which are turning out excellent work can be helped by some relaxation or rereading of the conditions of the grant, etc. So that is a different issue altogether. They are a privately funded private institution, therefore they have some extra difficulty. That's the reason why they are suffering. The rest of it, of course, why they are not doing anything at all, Mr. Rajiv Malhotra, leave aside the funding part of it, what are they doing to understand the threat and answer it or try and do something about it is something which Rajiv Malhotra ji will answer.
Yeah, thank you. So I have explained in this book why the traditional silence, and I've explained lack of language skills, lack of understanding the idiom and Western thought, and the brightest ones are often picked up and taken overseas and brainwashed, and then the dependency on foreign adhikar to stamp us approval, kind of inferiority complex, not being confident enough. I've cited a lot of reasons. I've got several pages on why there is no home team. Why is there no traditional Sanskrit home team right now? Why doesn't it exist? And I also see a certain arrogance, okay? A very prominent traditional person in the Bangalore area, very upset. We actually wanted to honor him and invite him as a chief guest. Very, very dismissive of my work, saying, who is he? What is he doing? Almost like I'm stepping on his turf. There's also that turf jealousy. So my point is that, listen, I would love to have you do the Purva Paksha. In all these 30 years, you've not written a single thing which is a critique of Western Indology. I would love that. My whole purpose is to hand over this project to people like you, so I can finally go back and retire, because I'm already 65 plus and I'm working all this day and night. I need to retire. I need people like you to take over. So it's not like I'm stepping on your turf. I have no ambition to take over anybody's position. But don't feel jealous about it. I'm taking the risk, sticking my neck out, working hard, doing the best I can. And maybe you're better than me, which is exactly why I wrote this, so that you can take it forward. So there is also that kind of, jealousy or feeling that threatened, that why is this guy coming? Who is he to tell us all these things about our own shortcomings? So it's a multifaceted problem. And this book is going to trigger a lot of discussion and debate, which is very good. And that way, new things will come. Thank you.
Sure, sir. Just one more question. This is regarding debates, essentially. Most of the debates that people are today exposed to is, on the TV. And most of them are pretty much unwatchable, for various reasons, because of the anchor shouting or the kind of topics which are chosen for the debates. How do you bring the actual good tradition of debate back to the mainstream?
I don't know. The mainstream, I can't get into the mainstream. I can't bring others in. They are scared of this because they're unqualified. They're very, they got a standard few lines to talk about, which they've learned generally very westernized, leftist. and very scared to bring a person like me because I can speak in their language, in their idiom, give it right back, tell them all kind of things. And they are really threatened by this kind of book. So, but we are going to prevail because we have numbers on our side. They are actually in a corner. They are elitist and very, they have more powerful people in very important positions, but they are not numerically that many. I realized that. You know, I'm going to give a talk and a whole panel discussion in JNU this February 1. And Tata Institute of Social Sciences in Bombay, 28th, I guess, or so, of January. So, I've been going to their turf, and I find more and more students coming on our side. More every time I come, they want it more and more. There is a thirst for this, but we just haven't had enough people stand up and supply that what they're looking for, what our people are looking for. At some point in time, the uprising in the social media will become non-ignorable, and the mainstream media will have to start giving us an equal voice. At some point.
Definitely, sir. And lastly, I see a lot of Sanskrit phobia. And is there a connection of Sanskrit phobia with Hindu phobia?
Yes.
What are your thoughts?
I wrote a paper on geopolitics and Sanskrit phobia in 2005 at the World Sanskrit Congress in Bangkok. And there was the 10-year anniversary of that. Last year, I spoke again. And that was the title of my paper, Geopolitics and Sanskrit Phobia. And I described all of this. The relationship between Sanskrit as a civilization and Hinduism is very deep. And often, they are anti-Sanskrit is a kind of a way to be anti-Hindu. It's just another way of doing the same thing. Yeah.
I met you many years ago in the Waves Conference in Washington, I think also once. But my question is mostly, I'm a scientist as well as a Vedantin. From science side, I find that I'm trying to inculcate, at least for the young students, because they're always a publish and perish attitude, where they want to get approval from the Western minds for their success or for their to be known. And unfortunately, the managers also insist that how many papers you have published in the Western journals, and then only they give a promotion. That is a psychology. The reason I'm bringing it Therefore, the idea is you solving problems of not of Indian interest, but something related to everybody else. Same psychology has to be, looks like from Indology, I was trying to look at paper to see how I respond from it. But most of the languages and also the references are everything coming from the Western only. And to solve that problem, Russians don't go to Russia to publish there. You have to have your own journal to start with. In order to do that, you should have a journal of your own where you can encourage it and you can publish it and rebuke the papers that are there. If the professor doesn't take it, it's a professor's responsibility to give that kind of problem, because professors, only the students come for guidance to see what kind of project they want to work. Oh, they have to come. They won't come unless you give the project. So a professor has to make sure that, hey, this has been published. Is there a way of rebuting it in a proper way? For that, you need your own journals, because the other journals will not accept it. So these things have to be 50 courses government lakhs are pending. You have to spend at least some in terms of organizing a Indology journal in India itself.
Yes.
With the authors that are provided.
Perfect. So my proposal, if I ever get a hearing to the government, would be, don't give even a penny of the $50 million to these Western Indologists. First start producing a critique of Western Indologists. That's the Purva Paksha. Then have Indian journals, a major Indian journal of Indology, which should have world-class stature. And an international conference on Indology should happen in India. It should travel around different cities in India every year. And the best paper should be presented here. And this way, we will get the Uttar Paksha. Pose, I'm doing it in my own small way. I have put a lot of Purva Paksha points in this book, and wherever I go, I meet traditional scholars, I tell them, please give me help in the Uttar of these points. The points I've raised in this book, give me your responses. And there is interest from Melkote, from places in Karnataka State, Sanskrit University, yesterday's Sanskrit University here in Chennai. There are these traditional people very interested in helping me. So they're saying my job should be to tell them what are the topics, what are the questions, where are the challenges, and their job is to then come back with responses. So if things work out, we hope that in the summer, this time July, August, or June, July, August time frame, we'll have the first meeting of this group of traditional scholars. And I'm assigning to them things to work on, and their job is to then come back with papers. So we'll do, every 3-4 months, we'll do a meeting like that. And then maybe in a year, we'll have good solid answers ready, and we'll publish them in, we don't have a journal, we'll publish them as a book, proceedings. And then we'll invite the opposing side, please come for a debate, because now we have a team. So first we have to prepare the questions, which I've done. Then we have to prepare a team to answer, which we want to do. And then we have a debate with the opposing side. This is how we want to take back our tradition.
Namaste, Rajiv ji. Thank you so much for coming out with this book. My question is regarding the theme of this book, where the West considers itself as the legitimate interpreter of our Shastras or our Shruti Pramanas and its connection to Christianity. Do you think this is a manifestation of Christianity's hatred for heathenism and Hindus being the last standing heathens?
No, no. Lot of the scholars are not Christian. They are Jews and they're atheists. So it's also a manifestation of the return of the Charvaks. Atheism, leftist, Marxist ideology is very strong. It is not practiced in the Western society mainstream. Very, please understand this. It's practiced in the Indian mainstream, in politics, left wing. Over there, what they call the American left is very mild compared to what we're talking about. It's labor unions, a few things like that. It's not really Marxism, okay? So in civic society, we have a very, very powerful left. America doesn't. But they have these left-wing people sitting in universities with six-figure salaries, sitting in Ivy Leagues, enjoying huge compensation, living the jet-set life, some of them, and talking Marxism. Okay? Yeah. So you have a hypocrisy right there. Okay? And their clientele are people like Indians, not Americans. They don't get limelight. These scholars do not get invited into the American media. Not one of those guys that are felicitated in the Jaipur Literary Festival and who come on all these NDTV and Times and places and all that. They're not in their own home country considered public figures. We built them up as, because they're white guys and we have inferiority complex. They're not there in public figures. So the interesting thing is some of them build their clout here and use that to market them at home that I'm a big name in India. So this is a very interesting thing. I'm a very dangerous guy because I know too much. I can tell all these things. Nobody is talking about this. So that's the, it is not just Christianity. Christianity is more sort of, we know about the threat. The threat we don't know about, it's very serious, is the new Charvaks. So please read this book where I'm talking about the return of the Charvaks.
Thank you so much.
Last question.
No, we have
one. Just one remark. I don't know how many of you watch the NDTV's new Ramayana. Watch it. And I'm not saying beyond that anything further. Watch it.
Yes. And there is a lot of articles that are coming out to respond to that Ramayana series. The gentleman who is the script writer and advisor on the content, well-known follower of Wendy Doniger and Sheldon Pollack, and mythologist of India. So this idea of turning itihas as myth. And once it's myth, anything goes. You can make your own. Popularized by a major, funded by a major business house in Bombay in the name of popularizing Indian culture. See how subtle it is?
What the peer influence? I mean, say for example, if I want to do least with my kid to uphold the Samskriti by wearing a traditional attire. I mean, the other kids fell upon her and make her not to do the time and ridicule her, and the peer influence is so much. And whereas in the Abrahamic religions, they don't have it. I mean, they don't bother. I'm much worried and how to pass on the Samskriti to the next generation.
Come to our schools, Vivekananda Educational Trust.
Come a little forward.
You just mentioned what everything depends on public intellectual. I mean, I'm confused. I mean, people, lot of like Romil Atavis, everybody talks about this public intellectual. According to you, can you give an elaboration on this one?
Okay, public intellectual is a person who is not speaking, officially at least, not speaking for a particular institution. If he's speaking for this party or that party or this government agency or whatever, then he's an intellectual working for them. Free thinker. So think of it as a free thinker. So a public intellectual is somebody who says, I speak for myself. This is my view. And he's really independently thinking. He's very creative, out of the box. He's got ideas. So that's a public intellectual. Unfortunately, in India, there's very little space for public intellectual, because even if you are a public intellectual, the media will say, are you left or right? Are you this side or that side? They'll put you in a box and then you are not free. So a true public intellectual ought to be completely free thinking.
So you said that Indian government should form a national Sanskriti commission to study what is happening in the West on Indology in the world. And then you also mentioned that the Indian government bodies are already compromised and they have infiltrators. So if we have a commission which does a study, then how do we ensure that the report which comes out is unbiased?
So obviously, yeah, it's a fantastic question. It's a great challenge, because obviously the infiltrators will want to get into the committee also. Yeah, that is the first thing they'll do. Like the U.S. has this U.S. Commission on International Religious Freedom. Yes. Okay, and I've always targeted, written a lot of criticism. The only guy who's just written in my book, Breaking India, I really exposed these guys. I've been to their events. Whose job is working for the U.S. Congress, official government body. It gives a report to the U.S. Congress and the president every year on the state of religious freedom in every country in the world, except United States. Exactly. It's a very strange thing. They don't have a single Hindu there. They go on blasting us, we don't have a single Hindu there. They have a couple of Muslims now because of lobbying. And mostly it is these very evangelical Christian groups who are in there, because then they can get their agenda through and they can put it to the government. And similar commission exists in Europe also. So I am saying the government of India needs a very no-nonsense. You see, the problem is, you're absolutely right. It will be very difficult to look through, because if they say, okay, these religious groups should appoint, some of those guys are confused. It is true. If there's some political groups should appoint, the most aggressive wanting to get in will be precisely the ones we don't want. So you have to look very carefully. I would say, if a person has not stood up against the opposing side, very publicly written and exposed very detailed, then there's some question whether he has the background. So if the work to be done is this kind of book, more of this kind of critique, then those people have to be people who've done it before, who have the experience to do it before, who have the courage to do it before. Not some guy who just got a lot of opinions and thinks he knows, but he's never published it. So that's got to be an intellectual body of people with a publishing record of our wavelength.
Yesterday you discussed about literarization and poison pills that are being built in the market, in the case of market failures, 1939 crisis leading to rise of Nazism. Currently in 2008 crisis, they have started building another poison variant of poison pill in rule of law and taxation, which happens in Oxford in England. I have identified it, and I want you to connect me to the experts. I am an expert in chartered accountancy, taxation, and yoga. If you could help me in connecting.
So if I understand correctly, because we talked about it offline yesterday.
Yes.
You have identified a Christian movement. Christian
yes.
movement?
Christian father propagating tax law.
So they are getting into civic society as if it is secular, neutral, economic policy, but there is a Christian agenda hidden inside.
Inside.
Okay. So now what you should do, you should publish it.
Lancet Commission has congratulated me for my work.
Who has?
Lancet Obesity Commission.
Okay.
They congratulated me for my work.
Did what to your work?
They said one line
They congratulated you for your work.
Yes.
So why don't you publish it?
I think they have not clarified it, whether it's a publication or not. But they said it's congratulations, we are very...
But congratulations doesn't work. Press private, congratulations, pat your back. If you want to take it to the public, if you want my help, you need to publish something. Send it to me, send a link, we can broadcast it, we can make you, you know, somebody who is debating this issue. We need people who have done this Purva Paksha. So you have done Purva Paksha of a particular movement.
Yes.
And you are giving an Uttar Paksha response.
Sir, yogic concepts and frameworks.
Okay, so this is very good. So he's done a Purva Paksha of how Christian frameworks in taxation and laws and whatnot are being propagated, and what would be the yogic frameworks. Okay, now we should help a guy like this. What I can do is, because I'm so busy doing all these things already, I can't jump in and help you with that, but I can promote your thing. You must get it published.
Okay.
Please get it published.
Yeah.
Put it up online. You know, there are places where you just upload it and put it online.
It's there, sir.
Then you send us a link and you send me a link, put it on my discussion group. Are you in my discussion group?
Yes, I have given it, you have published it also. So in the
okay,
group.
Then that is what it takes. Then we can tweet it. You have to make noise to get publicity like I do. You got to get on the train or plane and go flying around and give talks where the right audiences are. And give publicity to your Purva Paksha and Uttar Paksha, what is going on. Get limelight for yourself.
One last thing, sir. IMF, World Bank, and World Health Organization all agreed on my work. But if you could connect me to some chart accounts like Gurumurthy or someone whom...
Write to me great. And I will forward it.
Yeah, please.
And he knows Gurumurthy also very well.
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you.
Wonderful. Yeah. Yeah.
Good morning, sir. I have a...
Sorry?
I have a small doubt. You spoke about some Wendy Attiker and some other author. What is their basic flaws? Yeah, I want to know, yes. And Western Indologists, they have done lot of, I think, a good work for in folk literature and all. And they are the one who wrote all the regional South Indian dictionaries. They are the first people. So in that way, they have very done some useful things for us.
Yes.
Sir.
Yes.
What's your name? So, your name?
Satyendra.
Okay, good. Thank you. Thank so, you. Wendy Doniger is the name?
I don't know about him. I want to know what
no,
is his
I'm
basic.
Now I'm answering your question.
Huh.
You asked your question, now my turn.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
So, the first question is about who is this Wendy Doniger and what are the issues?
Yeah.
It's a book called Invading the Sacred on this issue. It's a 500-page book.
Okay, sir.
And you can go to my website and it's downloadable PDF free of charge now. Okay, so read that and you have a whole detailed analysis of what the issues are.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, basically it's a psychoanalysis of Hindu deities and gurus, making fun of them, a Freudian psychoanalysis, sexualizing all the symbols to kind of mock at them. That's basically what the issue is there. No. So rather than getting into a discussion here, you should read that.
The other person, sir?
So I'm coming to that. Oh. I'm coming to that. So the second one, where I'm talking about the problems with Indology, is the subject of my new book. So in this new book, I'm analyzing who are these people, what they're doing, what are the issues with it. So I don't talk just randomly, and I write a 500-page book on a problem. And each book, I've done five now, each book is a whole separate area. They are not repeating, I don't repeat the same book with the same ideas. Each book takes a separate set of examples, separate thesis, separate fight, separate battleground where we are being attacked. And I give a detailed analysis of that. And I try, and to answer to that, it is, you should now look at it, read it, and write a response to it. Yeah, thank you.
The dictionaries?
Okay, a lot of Orientalists wrote very good dictionaries. They did useful work. But when you look at Monier Williams' dictionary, you know, English, Sanskrit kind of thing. When you look at Max Miller's 40, 50 volumes of translations, lot of good work went, but in the good work, there is mixed in certain assumptions, certain translations, certain ideological biases in the translations. So this is a very clever thing. It is their poison pill that they've stuck inside very good work. I give you nice sweets, but deep inside, I put in something which is going to affect you in a certain way. So this idea, so for instance, the Aryan theory originated with Max Miller. But he did brilliant writings, but there he put that in. So everybody's enjoying, wow, how great is India, he writes all these kind of wonderful things. but in that is injected and infused with certain ideological assumptions. Monier Williams, same way.
Dictionaries.
Monier Williams dictionary.
I mean, in Kannada dictionaries.
I have not seen. I can only critique the dictionaries I've seen. Regional language dictionaries, people from our tradition would have to evaluate. People from our tradition would have to write critiques of these Orientalist written dictionaries. They would have to look for certain words to see whether those particular sensitive words have been translated correctly or mischievously. That's something I cannot do. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon, sir.
You know, just one comment, you know, or rather two. One is Ms. Max Muller, when he was commissioned, very specific purpose, to show that Vedas are absolute nonsense. That's what the work which was given to me, was commissioned for that. At the end of it, he had some change of mind, that's another thing. Second thing which I wanted to point out, 2008, there were riots in Orissa, Kandamal district of Orissa. And you would have read about it, a lot of things were there. And it was splashed all over the papers for quite a few days, almost a week, 10 days. And a lot of editorials were written. 1 week ago, the report of the judicial inquiry report had come. And it mentioned that conversion was one of the issues, was a major issue. How many people have been able to read it? How many people have commented on it? How many editorials have been written? Nothing.
Good afternoon, sir. I have a quick question on what we as Hindus can learn from the Christian model. In terms of seminaries, is there something that we can replicate which will get us a lot more better at what we do and get our message out there?
Yeah, I mean, I've always said that the equivalent of a Christian seminary is something we Hindus should have. Now, we have in Siddhabari, Chinmaya Mission has where they train Swamis, and in Annaikatti's Swami Dhyanand Saraswati has an organization where they train Swamis. So like this in Ahmedabad, the Swami Narayan people have. Everybody who has to do teacher training has some kind of an academy. Now, the difference is that the seminaries are very sophisticated. Seminaries do comparative religion. They do Purva Paksha of others. In the Princeton Theological Seminary, they have a dozen or more scholars who are expert in Hinduism. Somebody's expert on Dalit, somebody expert on Tamil Shaivisms, and how to read, understand, how to make friends with the various kinds of Hindus, how to bring them down, how to make them laugh, how to make them cry. They know how to do that because they're scholars. We don't have in our mathas a comparative religion. So one of the problems I'm raising here is we stop doing Purva Paksha of the others because we don't have such institutions. It is a job of such institutions to have done the Purva Paksha I'm doing. As an independent thinker, there should have been a lot of institutions in our country where the Hindu equivalent of a seminary, where we should have been doing Purva Paksha of all kind of people, what they're doing, what they're saying, what's our response, and educating our people. That intellectual corpus does not exist. This is neither in the political organizations nor in the religious organizations. We don't have that. We have quick. People will just copy, read a few pages and put out a blog and become the big intellectual. We have a lot of those guys. Quick copycat, but it requires tapasya. To really do it properly, you need people who are in it as a full-time life. They have to say, this is my life from now on. It cannot be that on weekends and once in a while I put this out to show off. So that dedication we do not have. And we do not have the institutional mechanisms. We need that. So I'm glad you.
May I just also ask a couple other questions, if that's okay?
Quick.
Yes, sure. It's not just at the intellectual level, but even at the very laukika level, when it comes to, let's say, tsunami relief, the church is so much more proactive than, let's say, Tirumala Devasthanam.
Yes.
So that is one thing. And secondly, somehow as a culture, when it comes to innovation and thinking original, we seem to have lost our sheen, and that is kind of manifesting even in industries.
Absolutely.
And the result is, I guess, a lot of the beauty about what you've taught us and what you've been sharing with the world is that it's authentic in its nature, and that's why it really works. But that clearly comes out of the 25 years of tapasya that you've done.
Yes.
So what is the equivalent of that, let's say, in getting, is there something that we can do when it's similar to that, which will help us?
See, the thing is, you have to have people who really are willing to sacrifice. You're sacrificing, and I can't impose on other people to change their lifestyle. I was lucky, I had a guru who transformed me. So from that moment onwards, I am not chasing all those same things I used to be. So what the moment you decide to put a 100%, 200% of everything you got into this, and you're into it full time, then your tapasya starts. So this is something, you know, we and I would say people who are swamis, I've already made that decision because they've already decided to sacrifice everything for that. So I think a high potential for me to recruit people would be to go to these spiritual organizations, these Hindu, different Hindu organizations, ashrams and mattas and all that, and catch hold of the young people who got a good modern education also, because they have the education and they also have committed their life to it. Now, if I can get them ahead more than just the teaching of that matta or that particular parampara and sampradaya, I'm giving them some additional thing. That is what I'm trying to do. So for me to do that, I don't want to start, I'm not a guru who's going to start his own organization. I would like to go to the existing gurus and add one course I can teach. For that, they have to welcome me without feeling threatened. They shouldn't feel that I'm an outsider teaching their students, and maybe they will think that they're inadequate and I know something. I have to convince them that I'm not a threat. I'm here not to steal your people. I'm here to just, I don't want money also. I just want to come and teach your people one other subject which I have expertise in, so it doesn't get lost after me. That's all I want to do. So I'm looking for invitations from good, solid Hindu organizations to go and teach a course.
I think we have come to the end of this session. It's really nice that we had a very good exposition of thought by Rajiv Ji and a very nice set of observations by Gopalaswami. We'd like to thank all of you for having taken off time, broke the trend and come here in the morning. We'd like to thank Bhatti Udyavan for this nice hall. We'd like to thank all the volunteers who have worked extensively to make this happen.